All right, guys, we're going to do another Bible study right now. We have a lot to cover, so we're just going to get right into it. Usually what I do is I'll give you a little update on our shotgunowl.net website here, and I'll go through all the features we have, but we've added a lot to it, so I'm not going to do that right now. But we have a lot of free things there for you that you should get, a lot of free things like MP3s, trainings, audios, debates, videos, things like that. We have a live chat room. You should check that out. But go check this out, shotgunowl.net. I'll put the link right below the video. You click there, you can go right there. Now let's get into the Bible study. And I think you guys are really going to enjoy this. You know, it's awesome that God has planted himself in the tenthly flesh of man in the person Jesus Christ. So if someone ever asked you, you know, tell me about God, all we have to do is show them the nature and the ways and the thoughts and the words of Jesus Christ. If you want to know God, look at Jesus Christ, and you can see this nature of God. Now, we're going to start off here with something that a lot of biblical scholars talk about, the radical change in Peter. Now, Peter had denied Jesus when Jesus had gone to the cross. He was fearing for his own life. But check this out. A lot of the disciples, when Jesus is teaching them, a lot of them desert Jesus. Notice that. But Peter's heart is right. He's got a good heart for Jesus, but he wants to be bold, but he buckles under pressure here, which we're going to show you. But look at, his heart was right. He just had like a courage problem. Not that we could blame him, because his very life was on the line just being part of Jesus and the rest of the disciples, their group. So notice, on hearing it, many of his disciples said, "This is a hard teaching. Who can accept it?" And I'm reading to you from John 6, where Jesus is saying that he's the bread of life. Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, "Does this offend you?" And this is some of the shocking teachings of Jesus Christ. So we name these Bible study series things Jesus said that may shock you. And Jesus says, "Does this offend you? Then what if you see the Son of Man," he's referring to himself, "ascend to where he was before?" He's like saying, you know, you haven't seen anything yet. He says, "The Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you," Jesus said, "they are full of the Spirit and life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe." So it's not like Jesus' disciples, every single one of them, were believing and following Jesus. There were some that actually rejected him. And you notice some of the disciples actually leave. But notice here, he says, "But there are some of you who do not believe, for Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him." So you know how they'll say God is omniscient, omnipotent, he's all-knowing. Notice Jesus' nature here. He knew which ones would not believe. Now, this is different than affecting their free will. If I have knowledge, for example, that something's going to happen, for example, I'm going to use kind of a funny story here, but let's say there's a mouse, and I see the mouse going up to a piece of cheese, and the mouse is hungry. I know darn well what's going to happen. He's going to eat the cheese, right? The mouse is going to eat the cheese. I'm not affecting the mouse in any way, nor am I affecting the mouse free will. So a lot of times you'll hear people say, "Well, how could we have free will if God has knowledge of it?" See, they're not getting it. There's no connection between God's knowledge and our free will. So watch this. So Jesus goes on to say, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled them." From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. So look at this. It's not like how people would tell you where Jesus is walking along and every single person's following him, and it's not like that. This is real. This is what happened. Is some people chose to follow him and some chose not to. So look at this. Jesus turns to them and says, "You do not want to leave too, do you?" Jesus asked the 12. Now this is a very, very beautiful and heartfelt phrase that Peter says. Listen to this. I mean, this just shows you the heart of Peter. Peter says, and imagine this, how he's honoring Jesus Christ. Look what Peter says. "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." Notice what they're calling him, the Holy One of God. And we're going to be talking about later another phrase that Jesus was called. Now watch this. Jesus replied, "Have I not chosen you, the 12, yet one of you is a devil?" And he's referring to Judas. Now, let's mosey right along here because I want to show you something here. What a lot of biblical scholars will say, and here we go right here, but let me switch this. So I want you to go to John 13, okay? John 13, check this out. What a lot of biblical scholars will say is that Peter denies Jesus, which you're going to see here. He denies Jesus Christ when Jesus is alive prior to going to the cross. So imagine this. They're following Jesus. Their Messiah dies. And I believe that Jesus resurrected. But let's assume for a moment that it could have gone a different way where Jesus did not resurrect. What would happen if Jesus did not resurrect is Peter would not get any more boldness into his life, because after all, what you're going to see here, he denies Jesus Christ even when Jesus is alive prior to the cross. So it wouldn't make sense for Peter to have a radical change after his Messiah is dead. You'd get real depressed and their Messiah's dead. And in those days, you know, there were always these false messiahs, and they would just come and go, and you'd even go get yourself another Messiah, right? Because they were waiting for the Messiah to come. So watch this. Jesus is going to tell Peter, because remember, you know, Jesus is all-knowing. He's going to tell Peter, look, you're going to deny me. And Jesus is talking about how one of them is going to betray him. And he's not talking about Peter. He's talking about Judas. So Peter says unto him, "Lord, why can I not follow thee now? I will lay down my life for thy sake." Because Jesus was saying, "Where I go, you will not be able to come, you know, just yet," right? So notice Peter says unto him, "Where are you going? Whither I go," Jesus says, "thou cannot follow me now, but you shall afterwards." You see that? So Peter's like, "Lord, why can I not follow thee now? I will lay down my life for thy sake." So notice the love and the loyalty that Peter has. Now, what's very unusual here is rather than complimenting Peter and saying, "Peter, your boldness is awesome," or "you are glorifying God," look what Jesus says. He says, "Will you lay down your life for my sake?" Question mark. Verily, verily, in other words, you can count on this. When Jesus says, "Verily, verily," he's like, this is definitely going to happen. He goes, "I say unto thee, the cock shall not crow till thou hast denied me thrice." So in other words, he's going to deny Jesus three times, right? So now watch this. They come and they take Jesus, right? And they seize Jesus. And so I want to bring something to you here. What happens is they recognize Peter, okay? Some of the people that were with the mob that, you know, sees Jesus, they recognize Peter, and watch what happens here. So I want to kind of mosey along here and show you what happened. Okay, so check this out. We're going to read now from John 18. So we're moving further on into what happened. Jesus is already arrested, and the disciples are terrified. You know, they're thinking that Jesus is going to get scourged and killed. And notice, it says here, and Simon Peter stood and warmed himself. You know, he's outside, it's kind of cold. They said therefore unto him, so they're recognizing Peter. Basically, they're like, aren't you one of his disciples? He denied it and said, I am not. Remember what Jesus said thrice. So that's the first one. We need two more denials. So let's mosey up here. And the further up here, notice it says, but Peter stood at the door without, then went out that other disciple, which was known to the high priest, and spake unto her that kept the door and brought him Peter. Then saith the damsel, so there's a woman there that's like the doorkeeper letting people in, and she recognizes Peter. And she says, art not thou also one of this man's disciples, referring to Jesus? Peter says, I am not. So he's basically denied Jesus twice already. And then one of the servants of the high priest, being his kinsman, they had a little scuffle in the area where they seized Jesus. And what happened is Peter took out his sword and he cut off one of the high priest servant's ears. So notice it says one of the servants of the high priest being his kinsman. So evidently there's someone that knows the high priest servant, who you follow me, who Peter basically attacked. They recognize that, did I not see thee in the garden with him? And so this is the third time. Peter then denied again, and immediately the cock crew. Okay, so you got that? Now, moseying right along here, I want to read something to you. So Jesus dies, okay? You got the story. You have Jesus is taken captive. He predicts that Peter's going to deny him. Peter denies him. He buckles under the pressure. He's afraid that maybe he's going to get crucified. But then Peter says that he's seen Jesus Christ alive. And something radical happens in Peter's life and all the disciples' lives. What happens is something unusual that doesn't make sense, unless Jesus really did rise from the dead, is Peter gets so bold now. Now he's not denying Jesus Christ anymore. He's actually openly speaking about it. Now, if you were not afraid of death, do you think that would give you boldness? I think you wouldn't be afraid of anything, right? You'd be pretty bold, right? So notice, Peter and John, the two disciples, they go in together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that enter. So there's a guy like begging outside because he's crippled. Who, when seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, ask an alms. And look what Peter says. And they've actually made a song about this. It's pretty good. Peter looks upon him, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, look on us. So picture this. This guy looks up, and they're not giving him any money. So he's probably thinking, well, are you going to give me money or whatever? But he pays attention, and notice it says he was expecting to receive something of them from John and Peter. But look what Peter says. Silver and gold have I none. but such as I have I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked, and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. So it must have been some spectacle, this temple where this guy is yelling and leaping and praising God, right? And just this beautiful thing happening, right? And all the people saw him walking and praising God. Notice what the scripture said. And they knew, because this guy was like always there, right? They knew it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. They knew this dude for a long time. He's been there a long time. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, and they were greatly wondering. So they know something happened. Something miraculous happened. They rush Peter and John, and they want to see it, what's going on. And they're almost glorifying Peter and John in a way, you know, like they did it. But look at what Peter says, the humbleness of Peter. When Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, "You men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his Son." Look what Peter says, Jesus. He's openly now talking about Jesus Christ. Before, he wouldn't even admit it to one person. Now he's admitting it to this huge crowd. What made Peter change his mind? I believe it was the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And he says, "Whom you delivered up and denied him even in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go." Remember, we did a Bible study where Pilate was trying to let Jesus go, but the enemies of Christ, they basically stirred up the crowd to force Pilate's hand to keep him. Now, look what they call Jesus. "But you denied the Holy One and the Just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you." Remember, Barabbas is released instead of Jesus. "And you killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead." So this is the whole focal point of the gospel, that Jesus was raised from the dead. And he says, "Whereof we are witnesses." Like, hey, we witnessed it. They didn't get it second hand, third hand, fifth hand, tenth hand, like, you know, some of the God haters will lie and say that. No, Peter witnessed it. "And his name through faith in his name hath made this man strong, whom you see and know, yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I wot that through ignorance you did it, as did also your rulers." Peter saying, look, you didn't know. You didn't know that he was the Messiah. He's saying, we know you didn't know this, but look what he said. "But those things which God before had shewed by the mouth of all his prophets that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled." When you guys get a chance, read Isaiah 53, which was written before Jesus was even in the tently flesh of man, and it talks about Jesus Christ. This is what Peter's talking about. So look what Peter says. He says, "Repent ye therefore." Boy, he's bold. He's telling them to repent and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you. So picture this. These people see this radical change in Peter. I mean, that had to be powerful. You can see it in his eyes. You could see it in his movements and the way he spoke. You could hear it. Something happened to Peter. The crowd sincerely believed Peter because Peter sincerely knew it. So look, Peter says, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things, which God hath spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like unto me, him shall you hear in all the things whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. Yea, and all the prophets from Samuel and those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. What days? Of the days when God would provide salvation for the people through Jesus Christ. And Peter says, you're the children of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all kindreds of the earth be blessed. Unto you first God, having raised up his son Jesus, notice, Peter's proclaiming the resurrection, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. So Peter's preaching it. But watch what happens here. And as they spake unto the people, and the people, by the way, are sincerely listening. They know something happened. I mean, the guy just got healed. The priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, and the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. But check this out. They don't like what Peter's saying. And they laid hands on them and put them on hold, in other words, in prison, until the next day, for it was now evening. But look at this miracle that happens there. It brings about 5,000 people into Christianity. Notice, it says, howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000. And it came to pass on the morrow that the rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and all these people, they were gathered together at Jerusalem. So look what they have to talk. Like, what are we going to do with Peter and John? So they put them in the midst of them. So picture this. It's almost like Peter and John are on trial there in the midst of them. And they ask them, by what power, by what name have you done this? Look at the boldness of Peter. Radically changed now, filled with the Holy Ghost, he says unto him, you rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, look, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. Now, you know, I'm talking about the boldness of Peter, and this is what they see. So they're seeing the boldness of Peter, and you know, when someone's bold and they're confident, it's really hard to come against that person, you know. And so here be the boldness of Peter and John. It's hard to really do anything, and plus you got the guy there that was healed, right? So notice it says, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. Now that's what they think, but Peter and John had a PhD in Christian theology. They walked with God. But they're not thinking they're all religious, okay, like they are, right? So they marveled, and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. They, hey, these guys been with Jesus. And beholding the man which is healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. I mean, you really can't win a little debate when the proof and evidence is right there, and plus the guy's bold about it. Peter and John are bold. So they're basically saying, well, what shall we do? You know, notice it says, what shall we do with these men? They are talking behind their back, kind of plotting, what can we do about it? They say, cause we can't deny a notable miracle has been done. We can't deny it. It's already manifest to everyone that dwells in Jerusalem. But they said, so they don't spread it any further. Like, okay, they did the damage already, but let's tell them not to talk about the gospel anymore. They said, let's threaten them. So they call them in again and they say, do not speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But since I've been on YouTube, the God haters have false flagged and attacked not one of my YouTube channels, not two, not three, not four, not five, not six, over seven YouTube channels, just because you speak the name of Jesus and you do Bible studies. YouTube's the most anti-God place, you can be in the world. The type of stuff that YouTube allows people to upload and stuff, it's just ridiculous, right? So you come in here and you start doing Bible studies on YouTube, you're going to get attacked and stuff. But I like Peter and John's attitude. I kind of think the way they do too, because look, they tell them, don't do it anymore. We don't want you speaking the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said to them, look, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than God, judge ye. In other words, hey, if we should listen to men or to God, that's your opinion. You can judge for yourselves what you're going to do, but here's what we're going to do. This is what they're telling them. Look, you can do what you want, but look, they're telling these guys, but here's what we're going to do. They said, we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. Like, in other words, we can't help it. It's just so epic. It's just so awesome. I can't help it, they're saying. We cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. It's bubbling up from inside my very soul. I got to preach it. So when they further had threatened them, they let them go. There's nothing you can do. You can't stop Christianity. You'll never be able to stop Christianity. Remember what they did with Jesus when they killed him? Look, even truth that is crushed to the ground will rise again, and no lie will live forever. So look, all the men were glorifying God for which was done. All the people that witnessed this were glorifying God, right? For the dude was like 40 years old, the one that they healed. So now let's mosey on down to another Bible passage that I want to show you. Okay, so let's go up here, and now we're going to wrap it up, and I'm going to show you the first person that actually gets killed for Jesus Christ. This guy is similar to Peter, very, very bold, extremely intelligent and educated about the scriptures, this guy, Stephen. So basically what happens is the early church, they get together, and look what it says. They're trying to, earn income and feed themselves and take care of the widows and stuff, but they also want to be able to spend time in the Word of God and also preaching the Word of God. So they have a little meeting, right? And they said, it is not reason that we should leave the Word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men. They get seven of the best men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. So that's the goal. They're going to get seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and the ministry of the word. And what's really interesting, everyone says, that's a wonderful idea. There's no bickering. There's no arguing. Look, this saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose, look who they chose, Stephen. Who is this guy, Stephen, to be chosen from amongst this group of people? Scripture says he was a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. And they also chose Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. But let's get to Stephen, because this is what this is about. Now, it says, whom they set before the apostles, and when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them, and the word of God increased, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly. Remember, truth crushed to the ground will rise again, right? So this is what's happening. And a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. Now, look what happens here with Stephen. This guy is just epic. He's full of faith and power, and he did great wonders and miracles among the people. But, you know, whenever you are reading scripture and you see someone that's just doing great works and stuff, you'll notice the enemy comes. And there's a lot of jealousy, it seems, where the people are jealous of people like Stephen. Because look what happens. Then there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the Synagogue of the Libertines and Cyrenians and Alexandrians, and of them of Cilicia and of Asia, disputing with Stephen. So they're having these philosophical, theological debates, these disputes. The problem, though, is Stephen, he knew what he was talking about. You couldn't beat him in a debate. You couldn't beat him in these theological conversations. Look, when it says they weren't able to resist, what they mean is he was so good they weren't able to defeat him. It says, and they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. And you know what? That must have been very aggravating to Stephen's enemies. So what do you do? What does human nature do when they just can't do it? They're going to create lies about Stephen. Remember, they did that about Jesus. They said Jesus was going to destroy the temple and all this other stuff. So what are they going to say about Stephen? They suborned men, which said, we have heard him speak great blasphemous words against Moses and against God. And it's the complete opposite. Stephen was honoring Moses and God, right? But this is what they do, right? And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes. They tried to keep getting more and more people in on the lie. And they caught him and brought him to the council. And they set up false witnesses which said, this man never quits talking. Look, this man ceaseth not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place in the law. What a bunch of liars these people are to say this about Stephen. For we have heard him say that, now look what they say here, that this Jesus of Nazareth, because Stephen was going around talking about Jesus, right, shall destroy this place, another big fat lie, and shall change the customs which Moses delivered us. Now, I don't know how Stephen looked, but he had a certain look to him which was very unique. Because look what it says here. It says, and all that sat in the council looking steadfastly on him saw his face, interesting, look, as it had been the face of an angel. Now, we're going to, my allergies are kind of kicking up, so I sneeze as I go through this. Then it says, then said the high priest, are these things so? Now, Stephen does this long history of how the prophets were talking about the coming of the Messiah, Jesus Christ, the Holy One. And what's really interesting, and I didn't really get this till I read this a few times, I didn't really understand, what is Stephen getting at, you know, as he's going through this history. So what Stephen does here, okay, now you definitely want to read Acts 7. It's one of the most epic speeches I've ever seen. He goes through a history of how, since the beginning of time, that God has been sending prophets that are saying the Messiah is going to be coming, salvation is coming, Jesus Christ is coming. And he goes through how when these prophets would come, the people would rebel against God. They'd even kill the prophets. And so as you're going through this, you're like, why is he saying this? Well, there's a surprise at the end. I'm going to show you what Stephen says at the end, right? There's a reason why he's talking about how these the fathers of these people that he's talking to, when he says fathers, he means their fathers and their fathers, like generation after generation. There's a reason why he's talking to them about why they keep rejecting the people that God sends, right? So watch this. I'm going to go through part of it and point out little things, and we're going to lead up to it, and then I'm going to show you where they kill Stephen. They kill him because of what he's saying here, because what he is saying, I want you to imagine something so truthful, so pure in truth, and so powerful that it ticks these people off, because it's like he hits the bullseye smack dab in the middle of the bullseye, and he's basically saying, here's what your problem is, people. This is what he's saying. And they can't take it because he's so right. He's so right, and they felt ticked off because of what he said. So watch this. He starts off and he says, men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. Like, listen. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Charan. And he said unto him, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred, and come into the land which I shall show thee. Now he goes through this history, notice. Then he came out of the land of the Chaldeans, and he goes through all that, right? And then he talks about how the people rebel against God, and then he talks about how Joseph was sold into Egypt, another bad thing that they do of God's chosen, right? And then he talks about the Pharaoh. And then he talks about how Jacob went down into Egypt and died, he and our father. So he's going through all this, right? Now he says, and when 40 years were expired, there appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai an angel of the Lord in a flame of fire in a bush. And when Moses saw it, he wondered at the sight. And as he drew near to behold it, the voice of the Lord came unto him, saying, I am the God of thy fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses trembled and durst not behold. Then said the Lord to him, put off thy shoes from thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground. I have seen the affliction of my people which is in Egypt, and I have heard their groaning, and am come down to deliver them. And now come, I will send thee into Egypt. And then he talks about how Moses refused, saying, you know, who made me, you know, who made thee a ruler and a judge? And Moses says, look, I don't know how to talk. I'm not a good speaker and stuff, you know. And so he goes through all this. Notice it says here, and Stephen's leading up to it, he says, to whom our fathers would not obey, but thrust him from them, and in their hearts turn back again into Egypt. So he goes on and on and on, and he's going through this. So as I'm reading this, I'm like, what is Stephen getting at? And when he's finally done, you realize, oh my gosh, it was brilliant what he said. He basically, in this speech, he sums up what the problem is how all of Scripture is pointing to Jesus Christ. He basically lays it all out there, and you go, I get it. It's all pointing to Jesus Christ. So watch this. So Stephen was very wise to wait to the end to say what I'm about to tell you that he said, because it ticks him off. So watch this. He says, which also our fathers that came after brought in with Jesus into the possession of the Gentiles, whom God drave out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David. He's going through all the fathers, right? Now, he says, who found favor before God and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. But Solomon built him a house. Howbeit, Stephen says, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet. Heaven is my throne, and earth is my footstool. What house will you build me, saith the Lord? What is the place of my rest? Hath not my hand made all these things? So he's quoting Scripture. Now he lays it on the line. I mean, talk about courage. Stephen had courage tons of courage, he says to these people, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye." He's basically went through the whole history of how people keep rebelling against God. They're rebelling against God's prophets. They killed the prophets, and now they killed Jesus Christ. And notice, he says, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears," basically, you're always resisting the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do you. In other words, you're just like your fathers. Okay. This was not a compliment that Stephen was giving them, but it was true. Then he says this fact. He says, "Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted?" That's like an accusation. Like, you know, every one of them, you're persecuting them. And he says, look what he calls Jesus here. "And they have slain them which shewed before." Notice, all the prophets were talking about who? The coming of the Just One, Jesus Christ. And now he really ticks them off. And this, I mean, I can't believe the boldness of Stephen here. He says, "Of whom you have been now the betrayers and murderers." He calls them murderers for what they did to Jesus. And then he says to them, "Who have received the law by the disposition of angels and have not kept it." This is heavy stuff right here. He's basically saying, look, and you received this law by the disposition of angels and you haven't kept it. Like, boy, you guys are in for it. Now, what he says is truth in its purest form. They go nuts. I mean, you want to talk about a speech that really just hits them in the gut. And look what happens. When they heard these things, what was their reaction? They were cut to the heart. He got them. Boy, did he nail it. This is the truth. And they gnashed on him with their teeth. They start attacking him. So why they're killing him, right? Why they're hitting him? Why they're attacking him? They're swarming him. He sees this, watch. "But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven." I want you guys to picture this. You see heaven, Jesus is on the throne, and he stands up like he's welcoming you into heaven as the first martyr. Like he's honoring you as Jesus stands up. Picture this. This is what Stephen sees. "But he," Stephen, "being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven." Notice he's focusing on this, why he's just getting buffeted in the pain and taking the blows and the hits of the crowd, "and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and said," and look what he says, "Behold, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God." And of course, that's going to tick them off even more because they feel guilty. You know, they know they're wrong. "Then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears." They don't want to hear what he's saying, right? "And ran upon him with one accord," like this huge mob coming towards him to kill him, "and cast him out of the city and stoned him." Now watch this. When they would wear these, excuse me, they would wear these like their coats, you know, this very thick fabric, you know. And so when you're picking up the stones and you're throwing them, you know, they would cast it off, you know, so they can move around better, right? And notice, "And the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul." Who is Saul? Saul is the person that has written Romans. This guy Saul was a persecutor of the Christians. His Christian name, we call him Paul. But Saul, he sees Stephen being murdered right there. And Saul becomes a Christian. He becomes a follower of Christ. And he is converted. And so Saul is basically like a little, he's like a one of these bounty hunter guys that would actually go capture the Christians and imprison them, and he would approve of them being killed. And even Saul becomes Paul. They would have new names when they would become a follower of Christ. They would have a different name. And he becomes Paul, and he writes Romans. Go ahead and read Romans towards the back of the New Testament. But at this point, he's not a Christian yet, right? So he's witnessing this. Picture this. Pretend you're Paul, and you don't like the Christians, and you're watching Stephen with as these stones are hitting him, and he's getting bloody, and he's just dying, and he's slowly falling to the ground. And he's listening to what Stephen's saying when Stephen's saying, "Behold, I see the heavens open, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." I mean, Saul's mind must have been blown witnessing this. He never saw anything like that, where people were talking about Jesus Christ and seeing Jesus at the right hand of the Father. Notice, "And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." This is what Stephen's, you know, hollering out as he's dying. So he kneels down, he can't stand up anymore, and cried with a loud voice as the stones are hitting him, "Lord, lay not this sin to their charge." Even in his death, he is still showing love for the people that are murdering him. And when he said this, he fell asleep. So God bless you guys. I hope you enjoyed this Bible study. Don't forget to get your free audio Bible. By the way, if you want to hear the rest of this, see how it says Acts 7? I want to show you something really neat here. When you go to shakanow.net, look for where it says audio Bible. And I'm having a difficult time finding it too. Let's look, because I got so much stuff here for you guys. Well, let's do it in order. Let's see. Oh, here it is, right here. See where it says free audio Bible right here in the middle? You click it like this, right? Now, we were just reading from Acts 7, right? So if you want to hear the rest, what you do, if you don't want to wait for me to do another Bible study, try to do them as often as I can. Excuse me. What you do, whoops, I passed it. My mouse wheel here was flying through. What you do is you go right here to Acts, see? And then there's Acts 7 to 8, so you can click stream and you can play it, and you could continue hearing it. And then you also could download it in MP3 format. So don't forget to go to shakanow.net and click Free Audio Bible. God bless you guys. Have a great week. Thanks for listening.